So let me remind you that we are discussing the generic or universal behavior of statistical systems near the critical point, which is the end point of a first order phase transition, right? We focus on Ising model just because it's the simplest example in this class, which allows us to develop terminology and formalism. What we have already introduced is useful. What we are looking at, something which in condensed matter, as I already said, is not really discussed very often, is the thermodynamic fluctuations around equilibrium, right? I mean, it is discussed, but not to the extent that these are the quantities which you would want to directly measure, as opposed to heavy ion collisions, where fluctuations one of the primary observables of primary interest, in particular in the search for the critical point. So that's why we are looking at fluctuations, and we introduced for this purpose the probability distribution for a coarse-grained field M, it's a functional, and express it in terms of functional omega, right, which is essentially, if you think about it, is a free energy, right? But free energy for the spatially varying field. In particular, if you coarse grain over the whole lattice, so if M is just the average magnetization, then omega is a free energy. What we did so far is we used the Gaussian approximation to express omega in terms of the deviation from the mean, right? So the quadratic terms are 1/2, one half Rm squared or delta m squared plus z divided by 2 gradient of delta m squared. And then using this simple approximation, we can calculate correlation function. And the simplest one we could calculate was this, just reproducing the results to which I will be referring to. That gives us t over z 1 over 4 pi. So essentially the Coulomb law, this is y, at short distances and at distances longer than the correlation lengths, it's a Yukawa law, right? So the correlations are cut off. And in particular, if we want to consider the fluctuation of the total magnetization, which is, or the average over the whole lattice, which is the integral of m of x, then that fluctuation can be calculated integrating this correlation function. And we get 1 over v. So there are two v's from, well, there is a one v, there are two v's from just the definition of m when we do the translation. And then there is one of these v's is cancelled by the overall integration, right? So t over z times xi squared. And the divergence when xi goes to infinity can be understood as when xi goes to infinity, the range of this interaction grows to infinity, and this integral over the separation of these two points diverges quadratically because there is one over that distance in the denominator, and we're integrating over a three-dimensional space. So we observe that the fluctuation variance, which is what that is inversely proportional to the volume, which is the manifestation of the central limit theorem, the average of independent variables has this property, and it grows with the correlation length. Of course, the same result we can obtain using the free energy, the fluctuation of order parameter m, which is the same quantity as here, can be expressed in terms of second derivative of the free energy. Should be inverse. Or if you wish, it's essentially susceptibility. The first derivative of free energy is the magnetic field, right? Did I get this right? So it's dH by dm. So there should be no inverse then. No, actually inverse, yeah, exactly. Inverse, right? But dm by dh is a susceptibility, right? How much m changes. And we know that susceptibility, we have calculated it, grows like psi squared, right? So it's equal to t over v times chi. And that matches our calculation of susceptibility as well. All right. So what we want to do now is to look at what happens to measures. So again, central limit theorem means that this quantity delta m, which is a random fluctuation of the total magnetization on that finite lattice, large but finite lattice, is approaching Gaussian central limit theorem, right? But what are the measures of the deviation from the Gaussian distribution? These are the cumulants, right? Or, as Claudio already discussed, the higher moments of the fluctuation. So that's let's calculate that. Before we do this, let me, in anticipation of the fact that this approach or these results are universal in the sense that they apply to any system, whether order parameters magnetization or in a liquid gas phase transition, the density, right? This is what distinguishes two phases, right? Liquid is denser than the gas, right? The same way as in Ising model, magnetization in one phase is opposite, that is different from magnetization in another. I will introduce a notation for this fluctuation. I will call it sigma and use this opportunity to also absorb this factor of z, right? So I will call delta m times square root of z. That way, my free energy for that field would look like an action, right? Euclidean action for a scale field sigma, canonically normalized with 1/2 here, right? So let me continue this expansion. Obviously, deviations from the Gaussians have to do with higher order terms in powers of delta m or in powers of sigma. So let me introduce the notation for this term. So it's the integral over x. So this is my now canonically normalized kinetic term. This is my term, which is now, I will write it like this. This is r divided by z, right? We already found that, sigma squared. And then let me introduce the notation for the coefficients of the lambda, for the coefficients of the high order terms. I will not go past the quartic cumulant or a quartic term. Again, this is sort of motivated by the reality of the experiment. In order to calculate high order cumulants, you need more statistics, Because you're basically looking at a probability distribution, which by a naked eye is a Gaussian, right? And so what you need is to tell the deviation from the Gaussian. Obviously, that would be buried in the noise if the data is not precise, if there is not enough statistics. So typically, experimentalists can resolve the cubic and quartic moments pretty adequately, but high moments are a problem that would require a larger statistics. But there's nothing which would prevent one to go to arbitrary order. I just want to illustrate what one does in order to discuss this behavior of this moments with the correlation links in particular. So we know that the second moment diverges with the correlation links with the power of xi squared. So in principle, this was one of the earliest proposals to look for the critical point, is to look for the width of the fluctuation. And that diverges like correlation length squared. However, there are limits on how large correlation lengths gets. And experiments suggest that this effect on the magnitude of the fluctuation, the width of the distribution of the fluctuations of order parameter, this contribution is not sufficiently large to be seen. What we shall see is that the deviations from Gaussian are actually much more affected by the proximity of the critical point. And it's easy to understand without doing any calculation, which I will do. Essentially, the fact that probability distribution becomes non-Gaussian is what these moments tell us. So we just want to describe this more quantitatively.
So if, yes, for example, this is a consequence that from the fact that Z indeed depends on T?
No. The nothing is a consequence of that, of what we discuss. What we didn't discuss, for example, the anomalous dimension of or the anomalous scaling. This power here is not exactly 2. If you go sufficiently close to the critical point, it's different by 3.5% or so, right? So that is due to the fact that Z scales with that very small power, which from the point of view of heavy ion collisions, you cannot get so close to the critical point. Correlation lengths cannot get large enough in order for us to worry about that, right?
So then these terms, where do they come from?
Well, they come from the fact that generically functions are not quadratic. Right, Taylor expansion has all the terms, right? And perhaps non-trivial question you can ask, well, sigma to the fourth obviously is there, right? There has to be something to stabilize the potential when this term changes sign, right? I mean, when R changes sign, right? Right, but where does this come from? Well, remember that when we are in general, when we are at a non-zero value of magnetic field, there's a generic point on the phase diagram, right? The symmetry is broken. So, but we are still expanding around the minimum of this potential, right? So that means that, well, expansion around the minimum should contain that term as well, right? And the coefficient here will tell us how far we are from h equals 0 line, right? When h equals 0, this term will vanish, because then omega has to be symmetric with respect to sigma to minus sigma, right? Right? Yeah, so think about the probability distribution of the order parameter, right? So it's consider Landau theory, which is the simplest example. So the potential in Landau theory is simply r phi squared divided by 2 plus u divided by 4 phi to the fourth minus h phi, right? So when h equals 0, then of course you get this if r is negative or something like this, if r is positive, right? If you exponentiate it with a minus sign like in that formula, you will get these two peaks or one peak, right? But now if we apply non-zero, if h, so this is h equals 0, both of them. But if you apply non-zero magnetic field, then you get something like this, right? With a minimum here and here, no longer the same, and you expand around this minimum, there is no symmetry, right? In fact, even if you expand around this minimum, which is at h equals 0, there is still no symmetry, right? So it's true also for non-zero h. As long as actually the average m is non-zero, there will be necessarily cubic terms. And of course, they will disappear above Tc, right? Because the minimum is now at, this is m, and this is P of m. Sorry, omega of m, or V of m. Oh, no, I called it U, right? All right, so given this potential, we can now improve on this calculation, right? Basically, let's first consider the calculation of two-point function and abstract some Feynman rules out of it. So it's 1 over V times T times Xi squared, right? That's what we get. And we can think about it in terms of a diagram, right? So Xi squared comes obviously from the propagator. It's an inverse mass of a particle at zero momentum, right? Times T, right? Because that's a two-point function, right? And the factor 1 over V, you can think of it this way. There is a factor 1 over V and 1 over V from basically the definition of sigma. Because it's the integral, right? Maybe I should introduce a different, let me call sigma V 1 over V integral over x sigma of x, right? Similar to m, right? So that's what we're calculating. So there's 1 over V here, right? And then there is integral over V due to the fact that this diagram can be anywhere, right? So this whole thing should be multiplied by V. So that's what you get. You can similarly calculate sigma cube V again. So it's a fluctuation. So maybe I should say this is delta M is called sigma V, and sigma of x, which is spatially dependent, is delta M of x square root of c. Right. So we just renormalize the field. So cubic moment, right? Well, can be calculated using the weak theorem. It's actually contractions. So the tree diagram looks like this. So you need a lambda 3 coupling here, right, to connect three propagators together. And now if you count the factors, so there's 1 over V from each vortex, there is T Xi squared from each propagator, and there is lambda 3 divided by T from this central vertex. That T is that T, right? It's lambda 3 divided by T. So if you put this all together, and remember there is also a symmetry factor, some combinatorics, T squared divided by V squared, 2 lambda 3 times Xi to the 6. So the factors which we want to focus on, let me first say the factors we want not to care about is this one. So what we want to focus on is the power of Xi and the power of V. Yes?
Yeah, that's one too. So if you can calculate the correction functions of the sigma V and not the sigma of X, doesn't mean that I have to take kind of the Fourier transform of the sigma of X so that you don't have the space?
If you think about it, sigma V is the integral of X, Y, and Z of a three-point function divided by V three times, right? So essentially, that would be that diagram. I'm just integrating over position of each of the vertex, each of the end point of this propagator. And that's why overall factor of V comes from. This whole thing should be multiplied by V, because this whole diagram can be anywhere, right? That's why you get 1 over v squared. So the counting is very simple in this case. So let's first look at 1 over v. So you can see that the cubic moment, which is the same as cumulant in this case, behaves like 1 over v squared. So it's suppressed by additional power of v compared to the quadratic one, right? Which is essentially we are here sort of proving this is the same argument that goes to central limit theorem, which is how we prove that in the limit of infinitely many variables, the distribution of their average becomes Gaussian, because the higher moments are suppressed by additional powers of the number of these variables that you average. Obviously, it's proportional to lambda 3, because remember, lambda 3 is the measure of the asymmetry of the distribution, and when there is no asymmetry, then obviously sigma 3 has to be 0. The less trivial factor is this Xi to the 6. I will give another sort of mnemonic reason to get to this power, but in our calculation, it appears quite naturally there are just three propagators, each of them contributing Xi squared, right? Because essentially, you are integrating over each of this point. The reason that this calculation gives us a better insight on the origin of this is because, well, it tells us that three-point function is similar to the two-point function, is also has a finite range at finite Xi, right? So these two points, if they are separated by distance significantly larger than Xi, are not correlated, right? Because you can see it from that diagram. All right, so.
Why is there a V dividing lambda 3 in the vertex?
This? It's this T here, right? Because when you do perturbation theory, the coefficient of sigma to the fourth is lambda 3 divided by T, right? So that is an easy counting here. And similarly, sigma to the 4, which is a quartic moment, which obviously you would expect to be coming from here. Well, for the Gaussian distribution, the expectation value of sigma to the 4 is not 0. Why should it be, right? Sigma squared is non-zero. Why should sigma to the 4 be non-zero? In fact, it's equal, you know, you can use the, again, weak theorem, right? And there are three ways to pair those four powers of sigma, right? And each of them gives the same result, which is three sigma squared average. And since there are, three possible pairings, but each choice involves two pairings, right? It's a sigma squared squared, right? So that's the value of this, let me write it this way. That's the value of this quantity in the Gaussian, for the Gaussian distribution. So we subtract it in order to define the measure of Gaussianity, right? So that will be zero for Gaussian distribution. And that turns out, not surprisingly, is what is called cumulant, right? So from the point of view of diagram, it's actually diagrams, it actually has also a very clear interpretation. If you do the diagrammatic calculation, you will see that this subtraction cancels disconnected diagrams. Right. Remember, in Claudia Ratti's lecture, she showed that you can obtain this by differentiating logarithm of the partition function. If you remember, logarithm essentially eliminates disconnected diagrams, and that for the quartic moments, that is what it does. Right. So that's the subtraction. So it essentially takes into account all correlations which cannot be reduced to a product of pairwise correlations. That's what it does. So again, there is a factor of V, and you need to draw only connected diagrams, right? And there are two types of connected diagrams you can draw. You can draw a diagram, obviously. I will draw it in that order. You can draw a diagram like this, right? And there is another way you can draw it, is like this, right? So these are two possible diagrams. Each of them come with corresponding, so this comes with 2 powers of lambda 3. This comes with 1 power of lambda 4 divided by t. And with some propagators, which I leave you as an exercise to assign, as well as the symmetry factors, that's the result. T cubed, this comes from the propagators, and this t is divided by v cubed, which of course also easy to figure out. There are 4 1/v's from each of the ends when you average in order to get the total, the average sigma. And there is this factor v in front. So that's 1/v³, which is, you can see, is even smaller than this, right? The further you go, the cumulant becomes smaller. So there's overall common factor 6, 2 lambda 3 squared xi squared minus lambda 4. Xi to the 8, right? So xi to the 8 on this theorem is easy to see, because there are 4 propagators, each gives xi squared, and this has extra xi squared because there is another propagator here, right? So it's kind of very easy, and then the rest is okay. Yes? Minus comes from here, right? Sorry. Yes.
You're working at non-zero age.
Yes, in general. Yes.
So why there is no linear term in the free energy?
You mean linear term?
Yeah.
Linear term. We expand around the minimum.
We're expanding around the minimum, and assuming that around the minimum we're nearly Gaussian.
Yes. Okay. With this being the corrections, of course.
Why is there not a minus sign in the sigma t?
It's a very good point, because I think it. Doesn't really matter, but yeah, if you want, I can put a minus sign here. Yeah, it doesn't. right. So. No, because it doesn't involve a vertex. This comes from the minus which you get for the vertex, right? So the minus there is the one which is responsible for convergence of the integral. Otherwise, All right. Okay, thanks. Yeah, I was waiting for somebody to point this out. So you got the point. I thought I would be able to sneak this in. Okay. Right. Okay. So this was a somewhat cavalier calculation because, it somehow assumed that we can use the perturbation theory, right? Or if you wish, we could say that this is a calculation which would be justified if omega was already effective action in the sense that all the loops have already been taken care of, right? Then you only need to calculate the three-level diagrams. So, but in this case, we know that in an effective free energy or Ginzburg-Landau potential or action, if you want to refer to it in this way, these coefficients have to scale. Right, we worked this out for the quartic coefficient, but the same should be true for the cubic one, simply because the whole potential has to be scale invariant. Right, so what this argument is sufficient to determine the scaling of this with the scaling of this. Constants with psi. In fact, you can see that this result with constant lambda 3 and lambda 4 contradicts the scaling, right? The whole thing should be proportional to 1 power of psi, not 2, right? All right, so let us work out this. This is just a simple power counting. So remember our rescaling rule. We change x by a factor b. That changes correlation lengths by factor b. We figured out already that sigma should be rescaled by b to the power 1/2 in order to make sure that this term upon integration gives us a scale invariant combination. Then it's easy to see that lambda 3 has to scale like b to the power 3/2. You can easily check that. And lambda 4 has to scale like lambda 4 times b, which is the result we already obtained for constant, which we called u, the quartic coefficient, right? Which means that the scale invariant combination, for example, is lambda 3 times psi to the power 3/2, or lambda 4, or lambda 4 times psi, right? You can see that this would be scale invariant, right? So let me introduce scale invariant variables, lambda 3 tilde equals to, by definition, lambda 3. If we insist that t set some dimensions in this system, you can easily count that lambda 3 has to have a dimension, right? So let me introduce lambda 3 tilde so it's dimensionless. It will be a universal number, essentially. Lambda 3 divided by t, that will be dimensionless, times xi to the power 3/2, right? But this I also want to make dimensionless, so I add t as well, right? That would be my definition of lambda 3 tilde. And lambda 4 tilde is another, lambda 4. Lambda 4 is dimensionless, so we don't need anything. Lambda 4 times t times xi, right? So that would be my... So you can see that... in a scale invariant, effective potential or effective action, lambda 3 shouldn't scale. That tells us that lambda 3 tilde. It means that lambda 3 has to scale like inverse of xi to the power 3 halves, right? And the same for lambda 4, it should be 1 over xi, right? They should scale to 0. So let me substitute then this into that formula. Then, of course, you can see that all the powers of psi equalize. So I can write, we can also do it here. This will also change this power xi, right? So that's the final result which I want to write here. Xi cubed is t to the power 3 halves divided by v, 2 lambda 3 tilde times xi to the power 9 half, and sigma 4 cumulant, c stands for connected or cumulant, is t squared divided by v cubed 6 times 2 lambda tilde squared, lambda 3 tilde squared minus lambda 4 times xi to the 7. Right, so these are the powers of xi, lambda 4 tilde, which corresponds to the correct scaling of this moment. Again, I remind you that we are working in this very useful approximation in which we neglect the anomalous dimension of the field sigma, which is just 3.5%, which is the precision which is more than adequate for applications we are thinking about, heavy ion collisions. But the main conclusion, there's of course v squared here, right?
This scaling means if I want to keep the physics constant long distances, then to scale the lambda 3, for example, like some constant over psi to the 3 halves.
Well, these are effective parameters which characterize the shape of the potential in a omega in a system which is at the critical, well, which is where the correlation lengths tuned to be as large as possible, right? At that point, the potential has universal shape. It's not something you choose. These parameters, lambda 3 and lambda 4, you can argue, are basically parameters which characterize the equation of state of the Ising model, right? The scaling, they can be simply derived from the scaling function of the Ising. And in fact, they are known, or rather they are dependence on it's a little, I would need to say more in order to, but they have been measured in actual lattice calculation in the Ising model. But the fact that I want to focus on is that these measures of non-Gaussianity are more sensitive to the correlation lengths. And that's the reason why experiments are looking at them when they search for the signatures of the critical point. They look at the deviation from the Gaussianity by measuring those non-Gaussian cumulants. All right, so I also promised a simple power counting argument which could give this, it just follows from the scaling. And let me just write it here. But it doesn't give us this idea that this non-zero value of this moment comes from the integration of a 3 or 4 point function, which is exponentially suppressed when the points are separated further away from each other, further than the correlation lengths, right? But just to get the power of the correlation length, the same way as we can get this power by a simple scaling argument as we did, we can get the powers there. So let's see. So we can say that the nth cumulant is basically the nth derivative of the log of the partition function, which is a free energy, right? So neglecting irrelevant factors here, like temperature, etc., I can write it's the nth derivative of the free energy, or omega, with respect to h, right? Remember that sigma squared is second derivative with respect to, it's actually, it's not completely correct. It should be the Legendre transform of that in order to be correct. Or, as we have seen, the derivative of f with respect to h, let me call f minus h times sigma evaluated at the minimum, actually m, at the minimum with g, right? Or we can say that it's basically it's a susceptibility. The first derivative gives us the expectation value, right? I'm just doing the counting, right? So it's sigma at a given h, and we differentiate it with respect to h n minus 1 times, right? So you can see that when n equals 2, which is just a variance, right, it's just d sigma by dh, which is susceptibility, right? So which we know is psi squared, right? So, but now we can do the power counting using our scaling argument. Yes.
In the topmost function, is the expectation value of m instead of sigma.
Yes, it should be m. But if you want, I can put m. Two, but they are proportional to each other, right? Yes. Okay, let's put m here. Then we will be calculating, but sigma squared is proportional to, right? Okay, so let's put m here. Yeah, to be more. Yes, that thanks. That's actually makes it more consistent notation. All right. So how do we get this? So remember that m scales like the same way, in the sense of this rescaling rule, as xi. So this tilde means it behaves the same way under rescaling, as xi to the power minus 1/2. Right? According to our scaling rule, xi is b to the minus 1. And m is b to the 1/2. While h scales in such a way that that h times m is xi to the minus 3. Scales like, right? In order for the omega, which is integral, to be scale invariant. And therefore, h has to scale like xi to the power minus 5/2, right? It's very easy to do. And then you can say, all right, if m scales like this and h scales like this, then this derivative you can already see is 5/2 minus 1/2 is 2, right? So you have xi to the minus 1/2 to the minus 5/2, so that obviously just shows that we didn't make an arithmetic mistake. But it also works for all the high moments. So for example, if we have n derivatives here, then sigma n cumulant is scales like m psi to the power minus 1/2 divided by h to the power n minus 1, which is psi to the power minus 5/2 times n minus 1. And that gives us psi to the power 5/2 n minus 3. So for n equals 2, you get 5 minus 3 is 2, which is that's psi squared. For n equals 3, you get 15/2 minus 3, which is 9/2. And for n equals 4, you get 10 minus 3, which is 7. Right? So it's a simple way to get to that power without all the bother of. So what additional information then this formula contains? Well, it tells us something about the sign, by the way. Following the correction, there should be a minus sign here. So depending on the sign of lambda 3, sigma cubed can be positive or negative. And sigma 4 is quite interesting, because you would say, well, it depends on how big lambda 3 is compared to lambda 4. But you can already say that if you are on a at h equals 0, in a symmetric phase, when the magnetization is 0, lambda 3 has to be 0. And lambda 4 has to be positive. And, well, it is positive. And therefore, it will be negative, right? In order to understand the sign, in fact, again, you don't need to use this formula either. You can just look at the shape of the distribution. Remember, the non-Gaussian cumulants are measures of the shape of the distribution, right? Like the variance is a measure of the widths. These are the shape. Like skewness tells us if it skews this way or the other. And, well, cubic moment is usually normalized, and then you get skewness. And the quartic moment tells us whether the distribution is sharper than Gaussian or less sharp, right? So let us consider the plane in which I will plot magnetic field on one axis and temperature on the other axis. And since I'm focused at the vicinity of the critical point, I will put it at the origin. So I will plot T minus TC, right? So how does the phase diagram look on this plane? Well, we know that, so this is t equals 0, right? From t equals 0 to tc, there is a discontinuity in the value of the magnetization. When I change magnetic field h, magnetization has to flip, right, from minus to plus, right? And that's also the region where these two phases coexist. That is a coexistence line, right? Or the first order phase transition line, right? Or coexistence line, which ends at the critical point, after which there's nothing to coexist. The two phases are identical, right? There's only one phase at that point. So what does it mean that there is only one phase? It means that the distribution has only one peak, right? So if I plot m versus, well, probability of m versus m, it would look something like this, right? And the further away you are from the critical point, the more Gaussian it looks. What matters really is the ratio between the volume well, and the size of the system at the correlation length. If the size is much bigger than the correlation length, it's by central limit theorem Gaussian. But as you approach the critical point, it becomes more non-Gaussian. But in which way? So imagine that you're approaching it in this point. What should happen to the distribution? In order to understand that, let us look on the other side. When t is less than tc, what distribution do we expect here? Two peaks. So distribution, the same as here, would now look like this, symmetrically, of course, at 0h. right? So if you go towards the critical point, this distribution has to somehow morph into this one. It means it becomes less sharp, right? It should at some point become something like this, right? Before it becomes like that. Which means that here you have sigma, well, first of all, by symmetry, we already know that sigma 3 is 0. And sigma 4, by the argument of sharpness, must be negative on that line, okay? So right. In fact, the value of lambda 4 tilde is actually calculated, as I mentioned, is approximately 4. It's positive on that line, right? When you approach the critical point from this crossover side, the lambda, of course, it runs very slowly, but on a moderate size lattice, its value is approximately 4, just to give you the idea. Now, of course, lambda 3 is 0, right, on that line here. And lambda 3 is 0. Now, what happens here? Well, you would say, shouldn't the, well, sigma 3 obviously should become negative, right, naively. Sigma to the 4 negative and sigma cube should be 0. But this would be wrong because you are calculating the cumulants relative to the point, which is not the maximum. Right? Remember that your system is either on this side or on this, either in this phase or in this phase. Right? So if you have infinitesimally small magnetic field, it will help the system to choose which one. But whatever it chooses, it will be either in this maximum or on the other side, it will be on the other, in the other maximum, right? And in both cases, the distribution around this point is not symmetric. It means lambda 3 is not 0. Right? And the value of lambda 3, in fact, this point is actually known in the same way as this one, is approximately 8. So sigma 3, well, again, is not 0, and its sign depends on whether on this side or on this side, right? If you're on this side, there's more weight to negative values of sigma, right? To values of sigma smaller than the mean. It means the sigma cube will be negative. So on this side, sigma cube will be negative. On this side, it will be positive, right? So let me... lambda 4 is also known. It's approximately 20. It's just a number which reflects the dynamics of this system. And as a result, sigma 4 here is not negative. Because, yes, this is a negative contribution, but 8 squared times 2 is bigger than 20, right? So sigma 4 is actually positive. Right. So this is a simple argument, but again, you don't even need to go through the trouble of calculating this coefficient if you just look, let's say, at this formula. If by some calculation, like either in Landau theory or epsilon expansion, you actually have equation of state, m as a function of h at a given temperature, you can calculate any moment you want, right? Confirm this simple analysis.
On the coexistence line,
well, the well, it has a measure zero, right? So the lambda 3 has to switch sign, and lambda 4 is continuous, but it has a kink, obviously, right? Its derivative with respect to h will be discontinuous, right? So if you look, for example, how this looks like, suppose I plot, well, for lambda 3, it's kind of easy. Let's look for sigma 4, right? Sigma 4, right? How does it look like in a density plot, right? Well, obviously, it has a singularity here because xi is infinite at that point, right? This is t minus tc, and this is h, right? It's negative here, so if there were different color, and there is, I can just color this red for negative, right? And it's positive here. I don't have blue. And yellow doesn't really suggest positive. So I will use white, right? So it's positive here. Obviously, if you go around the critical point rather than through, there is no discontinuity, right? So this sign should change at some point. So where does this happen, right? Obviously, there should be some kind of wedge here where it's still where it's still negative, right? And outside it becomes positive with a magnitude of either positive or negative becoming larger as you are closer to the critical point, right? So here it's a little bit less dense if you think of density plot, and here it's more dense. So this is the picture you will get. It's kind of hard, right? And this boundary line, you can actually figure out that it is not a straight line, because that would violate the scaling. Because the relationship R over H equals constant is not scale invariant. What is scale invariant is R to the power 3/2 divided by H is constant. Because that is a scale invariant, right? Because H scales like R to the 3/2. And that's the boundary here is basically given by that sort of curve. Yes?
Yeah, the boundary, what happens? Is sigma 4 0 or?
At the boundary, sigma 4 is which boundary? Here.
The boundary between the red and white.
Zero. Yeah, but it changes sign.
But how can it be, how can it go to infinity and then still change sign in the boundary?
1 over x, it goes to infinity and changes sign.
No, but
at x equals 0. Why is that possible and that is not?
I think what he's saying is that if you come along the vertical line, it seems you have to go to minus infinity. Whereas if you come to the from the horizontal, you have to go to plus infinity.
Yes.
So if you come from the border, you go to zero also.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's a singularity. So the value of the function depends on the direction that that you approach it, right? Right? Makes sense? Yeah, you can, for example, look at this formula. Right? So if you go along a line like this, then these coefficients are constant, right? While the correlation length increases. But these coefficients, their value depends on what this ratio is. So if this ratio is, let me put it this way. H over R to the 3/2. If this ratio is 0, then you're approaching along this line, right? Then it's negative. The coefficient here is negative. But the absolute magnitude increases with the correlation length. If you approach from this direction, it's right. You can easily think of a function which has this property. Think of, for example, the following function, 1 over r times cosine theta. As a function of polar angle, so this is r and this is theta, right? It has the property which there is a direction at which, like this direction, it is zero. And this direction, it's negative, becomes infinitely negative, and so, right. It's similar, except that instead of 1 over r, there are powers determined by the critical exponents. Okay, right? So this is what I wanted to discuss in terms of critical behavior of the non-Gaussian measures of the fluctuations, because they come up when we discuss the search for the critical point in Hevian collisions. It's kind of all right. Okay, so let me do another step before I go to Hevian collisions, which probably going to be already tomorrow, but we'll see. Let me talk about thermodynamics a little bit. So my goal here is to make the connection between the critical phenomena in this simple model and the critical phenomena in the liquid gas transitions, or QGP and hadron gas transitions, right? So this is what we are thinking about. Of course, there is a certain degree of universality. So in order to discuss thermodynamics, we want to also consider energy as one of the variables which characterize the system. So let me give you the view of thermodynamics which I like to keep in mind when I do this discussion. So the sort of the frame of mind which I want to set. So again, it's easy to understand first in terms of this model of Ising model, right? So far we characterize each state just by magnetization, right? But in order to discuss, for example, temperature dependence, or actually discuss temperature, what temperature is, right? We need to introduce energy, right? Each state of the system is characterized, there is a Hamiltonian, you know, the interaction between the spins. For each configuration can be calculated, right? So each configuration has its own energy, in addition to the average magnetization. So let me introduce energy E, as well as magnetization M. And both of them I will consider per site, just so for the same reason. So it's the energy, total energy divided by the number of sites, or by the volume of the system. So the important property and the framework which I want to set up in that view, the most important property in thermodynamics is entropy. That's what connects mechanics with statistics, right? So unlike energy and magnetization, which is property of each configuration, right? Entropy is different. That is a statistical quantity, right? Entropy is related to the number of, it's a property of the whole ensemble. It's a quantity which counts the number of states, or the, which is essentially equivalent to, or the measure of our ignorance about the actual state of the system. The more states are in the ensemble, the less probability will be that if we guess in which state it is, right? There are that's basically what the entropy is. We will define it in a sort of way which, of course, follows from a standard definition. But I will do some shortcut. I will define it as usually log of the number of states in the ensemble. Of course, when we talk about ensemble, we talk about a subset of all states of the system which are similar to each other, right? Similar in the thermodynamic sense that whatever quantities we use to describe this system are the same in all those states, or similar within this, you know, range of our precision, if you wish. And these quantities are energy and magnetization, right? So for each value, we select certain tolerance or so, and ask how many states are within that tolerance of the given values of E and M. And the result is exponential in the volume of the system. That's why it doesn't matter what the tolerance is. If you change the tolerance, it will only change it by the amount which is less than exponential. So in the thermodynamic limit, you can take the log, and it will be linear in the size of the system, which is the volume. And the coefficient is what we will call entropy, or if you wish, it's entropy per site, right? Normalized in this way. And this, of course, will be a function of whatever the values of the parameters which you characterize a given ensemble are. So I want to remind you again that energy and magnetization can be assigned to each individual state, while entropy cannot be assigned to a state. It's a property of an ensemble. You could say that it's a function of E and M, right? It's a property of the ensemble. And that function contains all the information about thermodynamics of the system. After that, you can calculate, as you know, all other thermodynamic potentials, right? Now let us proceed in a similar fashion as we did before and ask, okay, so we have ensemble, right? And we want to know what is the probability distribution of energy and magnetization in it, right? There is some most likely value, but there are fluctuations. We're talking about fluctuations, right? So what determines that? Well, depends on what kind of ensemble we're talking about. So the one which we discussed almost exclusively is the one where we imagine the system which is in contact with external external much larger system which can supply energy to it, and it thermalizes, right? And this equilibrium is characterized by the temperature, right? So we know from the usual derivation of the Gibbs distribution that the probability of a state of a system is exponential function of the energy with a coefficient proportionality, which is the temperature, right? So each state appears with this probability, with that energy, right? Remember that the energy of the Ising model involves also energy of interaction of the with the magnetic field. So there is another term which I will add, which is H times M, right? Which is the contribution. So this is basically the Gibbs weight of each state, right? But for a given energy and magnetization, there is not one state, right? The number of states or density of states is given by the entropy, right? So, oh, by the way, energy is the energy per site. and so is magnetization. So we need to multiply by the volume in order to get that correct Gibbs factor. And of course, there is a number of state which is an exponential of this, right? S, which is a function of E of S. So that's the probability distribution of these quantities, E and M, right? So what does it tell us? Well, first of all, we can connect with our first lecture where we were talking about probability distribution of M, right? So how do we get it? We integrate over E. So that's a simple exercise we can do just to see how this works. So if we integrate over E, we should get P of what we call P of M, right? Well, integrating over E is easy because, I'm sorry, there is factor of V here, right? In the thermodynamic limit, V allows us to do a saddle point integration, right? So basically what we need to do is to evaluate this exponent at its maximum and substitute here, right? So in other words, we should write V times S minus E divided by T, or maybe I will do it like this, T times S minus E, and I take out T, plus H times M exponential, right? Where E, which appears here and here, right? Should be a solution to a saddle point equation, which in this case you can easily see is ds by dE equals 1 over t. Right? So essentially this is a Legendre transform of the entropy, right, with respect to energy. And you can see that this is exactly minus F. And F minus HM is what we used in the very beginning, arises naturally. It's minus V divided by T, F minus HM, right? Okay. Now, what is the equilibrium state? Equilibrium values of E and M. Again, because of this large factor of V, right, this probability is peaked at a maximum of that function, right? So, so in other words, I have to calculate the maximum of, I have to maximize S minus E divided by T plus H divided by T times M, which gives two equations for two unknowns, right, in terms of T and H. So provided a given external magnetic field and temperature, we can find a corresponding energy and the magnetization by solving this equation. So ds by dE is equal to 1 over T, and ds by dM is equal to minus H over T, right? These are the standard thermodynamic relations. I just want to derive them in the framework which in which entropy plays the essential role. It will be useful to have notations here. I will call this beta, which is a standard notation. Of course, it clashes with the exponent beta, but both of these notations are so entrenched that I cannot change this. And here I will call alpha, actually minus alpha. Right? So if you wish, you can write the differential of entropy like this. It's beta dE. These two equations together are equivalent to that statement, right? Which, if you rewrite it as a differential of energy in terms of entropy and magnetization, this is your first law of thermodynamics, right? the energy can change by transfer of heat or entropy and by some work done by the magnetic field. All right. So we discussed where the maximum is, but we only apply the stationarity condition. How do we know it's a maximum and not a minimum or saddle point? Well, we need to look at second derivatives. Right, so let's look at second derivatives. You can see that if you are at the maximum, this linear term in E and this linear term in M cancel linear terms in S, and what remains is a quadratic form in deviations from equilibrium. So let me call this quadratic form like this, SEE dE squared plus SMM dm squared plus 2SEM dE dm. So it's basically quadratic or bilinear term in the Taylor expansion of the entropy, which determines whether it's a minimum or not, maximum or not. And these notations are kind of should be self-evident. Each index E means differentiation respect to corresponding variable at another variable fixed. It just shortens the expressions. Right, so that's what, for example, that means. So what is that quantity? This coefficient here, right? Obviously, it has to be negative, right? Because what does it mean for this to be maximum? It means that no matter in what direction you go, the entropy has to decrease, right? So, or rather, this quadratic form has to become negative. One possible direction, I set m to 0, and I go in the direction of E, right? So SEE has to be negative, right? So what is it? Well, we know that ds by dE is beta. So it's d beta by dE at constant m, right? Beta is 1 over t, so we can write it as 1 over t squared dt by dE also at constant m. And this is inverse of the susceptibility of energy to temperature, or rather this specific heat. So in other words, how the temperature changes when, energy changes when I change the temperature at fixed magnetization. So there is no work done by the magnetic field, right? So this is often called CV, right? Obviously, I will call it 1 over t squared CV. It's analog of specific heat at constant volume in the liquid gas, in the usual sense. And you can see that for this to be negative, CV has to be positive, which is a kind of well-known result, right? That may not be enough, right? Well, obviously, SMM has to be also positive. But that also is not enough. Because even if both of them are positive, if this is too big, then I can find some diagonal direction in which dE times dm is negative, and this term overwhelms the sum of this. So in order for this to work, the determinant has to be positive. Think about it this way, determinative product of two eigenvalues, right? Both of them have to be negative. The product of two negative numbers is positive. So the determinant has to be positive. So let's calculate what the determinant is in this case. Let's see. Determinant is, let me see if I can fit it here or not. Probably I shouldn't. So I move. All right, determinant um, I just call it for shortness. This is SEE SMM minus SEM squared has to be positive. And if I write it using our notations, it's d beta by dE at constant m times d alpha by dm at constant e, I think with a minus sign, plus d beta by dm at constant e and d alpha by dm dE at constant m. This has a simplified notation, right? I can write it using the Jacobian of transformation from beta alpha to me, right? Or with a minus sign from beta alpha to em, right? And so a useful calculation, just to refresh the operations with these Jacobians, I can use the property of Jacobians to write it this way. So minus sign. Right? And I can put here and here the same thing, but it could be anything I want. And I want beta m. Right? So then this is d alpha by dm at constant beta. And this is d beta by d at constant m. And each of this we already defined. Because, well, d beta by d is minus 1 over t squared cv. We just did that. And d alpha by dm, inverse of this, is dm by d alpha at constant beta is t times dm by dh, which is susceptibility. So it's t chi. So this whole thing is then 1 over t cubed chi cv. So you can see that thermodynamic stability, or in other words, the existence of a maximum of the entropy, requires or implies that both cv and the specific heat and the susceptibility are positive, right? Now, what happens at the critical point? So from this follows that chi is positive. Because we already know that CV has to be positive. Right? As usual, there are two conditions, right? Obviously, because there are two directions for this quadratic eigen directions for this quadratic form. What happens at the critical point? Well, we know the critical point susceptibility diverges. Right? So that means that this quadratic form, well, determinant becomes zero, and this quadratic form therefore becomes degenerate. It has a flat direction, right? And it has to happen in that direction. The fluctuations will be coming now unconstrained and very large, right? That's where it's coming from. What is that direction? So chi goes to infinity at CP. And therefore, determinant goes to zero. That means there is a flat direction. Well, it's easy to guess. By symmetry, it has to be the energy direction. It cannot be tilted. I'm sorry. It has to be either energy direction or the magnetization direction. It cannot be tilted. Otherwise, it violates the symmetry, m to minus m, right? Well, and we know it has to be in magnetization direction because those are the fluctuations which become large. In fact, I am trying to ignore the fact that CV also diverges, so the other direction also becomes flat, but much slower. That exponent is much smaller. So what is important, and in particular, for example, in van der Waals equation of state, or in the Landau theory, or in d equals 4, CV is finite, and therefore that argument would work. So there is a flat direction which is basically m. So this direction d over dm equals 0 is basically the flat direction. So in other words, the critical mode, the one which fluctuates, is delta m. And you can understand it also looking at the quadratic form itself. At h equals to 0, this has to vanish, because it's a derivative of entropy which is even with respect to m to minus m. Right? Number of states doesn't depend on the sign of magnetization. With respect to energy, which is also even, and magnetization. So this quantity is odd under this symmetry. So at h equals 0, it has to vanish. Right? So at h equals 0, which is where the critical point is located, the quadratic form just diagonalizes. And you can see that in this case, SMM is 1 over chi, and this is 1 over CV. So that is the one which direction which becomes flat. OK? So in this case, delta m squared is simply minus 1 over v SMM. And it's easy to see that it's equal to 1 divided by, t divided by v times chi, So fluctuation diverges because the flat direction appears. Now, so what happens in liquid gas? So let me try not to repeat what we did here, but just go through the same steps with just one change. Instead of magnetization, I will think of the particle number or baryon number in the case of QCD. So I will replace this with n, baryon number. And instead of per site, I will measure it per volume, per unit volume, right? Then everything goes through. So instead of h, I will have a potential thermodynamically conjugate to the particle number, which is mu, right? So instead of h, I will now have mu, right? And alpha will be mu over t. But everything else still works until we, so we can derive this formula. And we know that at the critical point, susceptibility diverges, except that now we cannot use the argument of the symmetry. Right? In the Ising model, there was a symmetry. M to minus M. Right? In the liquid gas transition, there is no such symmetry in general, and in practice, there is no symmetry n to minus n unless you are at zero chemical potential, which is not where this. And not even the symmetry with respect to n minus, let's say, n minus n critical or something like this. Let's say n critical minus m. That symmetry also doesn't exist. There's no reason for it. microscopically, the system doesn't know anything about the critical density or anything. It's just a result of some collective behavior. So what changes in this argument? Well, let me look first at the... I think I can reproduce this later if I need. So if we look at the phase diagram as a function of C and H, right, in the Ising model, it's symmetric, right? This is the critical point at TC. And the magnetization is positive here and negative here. It is discontinuous, right? Magnetization is discontinuous. Delta M is non-zero, right? But energy is continuous because it's symmetric, right? Its derivative with respect to H is discontinuous because it's odd, right? So there's a kink. But the value of the energy doesn't jump, right? So in a sense, this has is related to the fact that we observe that it's delta M which is a critical mode. Because you can understand the critical fluctuation in the following way. As you're approaching closer to the critical point, the potential becomes less and less separated by this central hump in the middle. And so the fluctuation becomes easier, right? And obviously, there are no fluctuation. These fluctuations do not involve the change of energy. It involves the change of magnetization from one minimum to the other. And that's the critical mode, right? So what happens with liquid gas? Well, liquid gas, T mu, or QCD, if you wish, doesn't have such symmetry. And in general, there's a critical point, and that's the first order line, which goes somewhere there. Right? This is how it looks like. And both delta N and delta E are non-zero here. There's no reason for delta E to be zero. In fact, it has to be non-zero because there is a Clausius-Clapeyron relationship, which relates this discontinuity to the slope. Right? So usually it is derived from dP equal differential of pressure, which is written like this. Right? So mechanical stability requires for the coexistence that the pressures are the same of both phases. Thermal equilibrium requires that temperatures are the same on both sides. And the chemical equilibrium means that chemical potential is the same on both sides. Right? But the corresponding S and N are different. Right? So if I calculate the pressure in one, the pressure in one phase, I will get something like this. If I calculate the pressure in the other phase, I get something like this with different values of entropy density and baryon density. Right? But they have to be equal to each other. Right? Therefore, this is equal to this. And after a short rearrangement, you can see that dT by d mu on the coexistence line, this is coexistence line, is minus dN, delta N divided by delta S. So discontinuity of entropy. And of course, a similar argument, you can also relate discontinuities of energy energy and N, and I let you derive this. So one can show the following, that differential of beta times P is equal to minus epsilon delta beta plus N delta alpha. So for E and N, the natural variables are beta and alpha, because these are the conjugate variables when you take derivative with respect to entropy. Right? Then repeating this argument, you will find that d beta by d alpha long coexistence curve is equal to delta n divided by delta e. So you can see, for example, that in the Ising model, remember, in the Ising model, the role of n was placed by the magnetization, right? In the Ising model, delta E was zero, right? And delta M wasn't. So this ratio was infinite, and therefore this line has to be vertical. So these are related. All right. The fact that both energy and baryon density experience a jump here is related to the slope of that curve, right? And so, right, depending on the slope, you will have different proportion of the discontinuity, and correspondingly, different fraction of delta E and delta N in the critical mode. So if we now ask a question, what is the direction in the quadratic form for the entropy in terms of delta E and delta N at the critical point? Right? So the determinant is zero. It means that this matrix, SEE, SEN, SNE, which of course is symmetric, SNN, delta E, delta M, or, you know, you think about this fluctuation. This matrix is singular, and it's easy to find what the ratio of delta E to delta M is. Right? It has zero eigenvalue. Right, that's zero. So you find that delta E to delta N is equal to minus SEN to SEE is equal to, again, using the usual formula, is the derivative of E with respect to N at constant temperature, which in general is non-zero. So in the liquid gas phase transition, the critical mode, the one whose fluctuations become large, for example, the ones for which the susceptibility grows like psi squared, is the one in which both energy density and baryon density fluctuate with that ratio, finite ratio, right? So this would be the property of the critical mode. So it's incorrect to say that the critical mode is the baryon number density or that it's energy density. It's, it involves fluctuations of both of them because of that mixing. So this kind of mapping of Ising model onto liquid gas phase transition basically proceeds along these lines. You have to map the critical mode, which in this case is a linear combination of E and N, onto the critical mode in the Ising model, which in this case is pure M. But after you've done this mapping, everything else remains the same. So the field theory which describes these fluctuations is the same phi to the 4 field theory, which has a Wilson-Fisher fixed point, which governs the critical behavior of the Ising model in the liquid gas critical point as well. Right. All right, so this is all what I wanted to say about the phase transitions per se. So the last lecture I will talk about phase transitions and heavy ion collisions, or rather, what experimentalists are doing in order, and in particular what theory is needed in order to compare experimental results with with the predictions from the critical point. So I will give a brief introduction into heavy ion collisions and hopefully have enough time to talk also about the signatures of the critical point. It depends what you mean by order parameter. So very often, implicitly, by order parameter, you could say it's a strong definition, right? Is a expectation value of some local operator which is not invariant with respect to some symmetry, right? In this case, there is no symmetry. So there could be no order parameter in that sense. In the Ising model, there is a symmetry and there is an order parameter, right? Why is it important, the symmetry? Well, because if the symmetry exists, it means that whatever that symmetry is not broken in the either ground state or equilibrium state at finite temperature. If it's not broken, the order parameter cannot be non-zero. It cannot be just be a little bit non-zero, right? It's, you know, you cannot be a little bit pregnant. That's, you know, something which you heard before, right? So it's either zero or not. And it's only possible if there is a symmetry. And because if you then argue, and that's what we discussed with the Polyakov argument, that there has to be a first, there has to be a phase transition towards quark liberation. If you can argue that at some other temperature, the symmetry must be broken, and the order parameter is therefore non-zero, then it automatically guarantees that there has to be a phase, has to be a singularity at some intermediate value of the temperature. That's why it's important to have order parameter in that strict sense, right? Now, in that strict sense, liquid gas phase transition doesn't have an order parameter, right? And because there is no symmetry. But if you think of the order parameter as something which distinguishes two phases, whether there is a symmetry or not, then there is. It's density, for example, right? The density of liquid is bigger than the density of gas, right? They coexist, so that's the parameter which tells you which phase you are in, right? But in neither of the phases, it's either zero or equal to some magic value around which there is some kind of symmetry, right?
So in which sense the theory is the same than the Ising model?
In the sense that order parameter or that field which describes the fluctuations of, let's say, the density near the critical point fluctuations are described by exactly the same conformal field theory. So you didn't ask, but I will go further to say that, in fact, the symmetry is broken. So let me maybe illustrate it using using this picture. So if we, which I drew already on the, so if this is temperature and this is the density, right? Typically, the coexistence, you know, the line where along which the phases coexist is described by this dome with a critical point at the top. So at every given temperature, there are two values of the density in which the system is still in equilibrium, right? So this would be, I guess, liquid because n is bigger and this will be gas, right? Now, well, in the Ising model, of course, the picture looks like this, is this dome is completely symmetric, right? In the liquid gas, it doesn't look like symmetric. If you draw a line vertically like this, it will not intersect this in the middle. There's a skewness in this, right? Usually what the way it's described is you find the middle point at each of the curve and ask how vertical this line is, and it isn't, right? So this deviation from this is called diameter, right? So this rectilinear diameter, if you wish. So now, however, when you approach to the critical point, right, the shape of this curve we already discussed, right? It's basically given by exponent beta, right? The difference between this and this is equal to, well, let's start with the Ising model. The difference between this and this shrinks as a power of t minus tc. Let's call it little t, right? Shrinks with a certain power. In the mean field, it's 1/2, or in the Landau series, 1/2. In reality, it's closer to 1/3. So delta m here, or m1 minus m2, goes like t to the power 1/3, right? Here, m1 minus m2 goes like t to the power 1/3 as well, right? And yes, there is a deviation of the from the symmetry. How do you see it? You do m1 plus m2, right? Well, in the Ising model, it's zero. In here, it's not zero, but it also vanishes, and it vanishes faster than this. It vanishes approximately linearly, like on this plot. This additional exponent here, it doesn't matter. But you can see that this becomes much smaller than this as you approach the critical point. So near the critical point, this asymmetry becomes less and less important. It's a sub-leading effect, right? So the leading critical behavior is identical to the Ising model. Exactly. So the this asymmetry is due to the irrelevant operator, which basically dies out, right?
I guess further questions can be addressed at coffee and cakes.